Okay, so hello everyone. So we continue the summer school IoT. So this day with now a presentation that will be given by Philippe Laurent. So Philippe Laurent, let me introduce round. So Philippe Laurent was graduated from the University of Liège in Belgium in 2002 as an electromechanical engineer. From 2002 to after his thesis, he worked as material and process engineer in aeronautics at Safran Aero Booster. In 2010, he returned to the University of Liège as a research engineer at the Microsys Lab. And in March 2016, he was part of the team that won the 1 million prize for the Little Box Challenge, an engineering competition run by Google and the IEEE Power Electronic Society. In June, the same year, 2016, he won the first prize of the 5G World Innovation Accelerator, so congratulations. And currently, Philippe is doing research in ultra-low power for IoT. And I think that the topic of the presentation will be on this subject. So, Philippe, the floor is yours.
Okay, so thank you for the nice introduction. Thank you for inviting me, and I'm happy to talk about energy harvesting and power management. Okay, so in the coming years, over 1 trillion of sensors are expected everywhere. So in your house, in your car, in the city, everywhere. So this is a nice picture. What a wonderful world. But in practice, that means billions of problems for humans due to the maintenance, due to the battery replacement, but also for the nature, due to the pollution with heavy metals and so on. So what can we do? So basically, an IoT device consists in sensors, a communication unit, a microcontroller, and a battery. So the battery typically is this kind of coin cell. Okay, so you see it. And the basic idea is to replace this battery by a energy harvester. That use these light, heat, mechanics, waves, etc. To power the microsystem here. In between, we need to add a power management unit. Okay. So an energy harvester is not a power plant. It is characterized by it delivers a low power ranging from microwatts to milliwatts, but not that high. It has a small volume up to a few cubic centimeter. This is important. In fact, the input power very often fluctuating. Considering the wind speed, for example, or the daylight. So we have to store the energy. As an example, this is a commercial product. It's in fact a battery-less and maintenance-free IoT device powered with a solar cell. So you can see beneath the PCB a solar cell, and this device hosts relative humidity sensor, an accelerometer, a pressure sensor, and a temperature sensor. So it's not that big. So IoT, the Internet of Things, covers several sectors such as home automation, smart cities, sport and leisure, logistics, industry, and health. So, first I will start with an overview of the energy sources, and then I will describe a few energy harvesters. So please don't confuse. Energy source is the gross energy, like heat, vibration, light. And energy harvester, an energy harvester is a device, really a device, used to convert the gross energy into electrical energy. So for example, with heat, you can use a thermoelectric generator. With vibration, you can use a piezoelectric generator. And of course, with light, you can use a photovoltaic cell. So let's start with an overview of the energy sources. This is a spectrum of the electromagnetic waves. We can use the light with a solar photovoltaic cell. We can use the infrared with a thermoelectric generator, but also we can use the radio frequency with an antenna. We have a heat flux when we have a hot source and a cold source. So the hot source can be an engine here, hot air, or a human body, for example. In fact, this is a picture of me, but don't worry, the picture was taken much before the COVID disease. So the cold source, very often we use the ambient air. So for solid mechanics, vibration is very often used. But also we can store energy, mechanical energy, using gravity or using elasticity. So like this, okay, so you have a spring and you can store energy in a spring. But in any case, we want to avoid losses, like frictions. For fluid mechanics, the kinetic energy is related to the density of the fluid. So for a given velocity, it's preferable to use water than the air. Why? Because the density of water is 3 orders of magnitude larger than the air, than the one for the air. Again, we can store energy using gravity, for example, using the level of a fluid in a tank, or using elasticity, so I mean the pressure of a gas in a tank. And again, we want to avoid losses. There are other energy sources like chemical. So petrol has a very, very high energy per unit of volumes. So the density, the energy density is very high. Also, we can use alkaline battery or biochemistry such as photosynthesis, breathing, muscle, etc. So now let's focus on the energy harvester, so really the device. First of all, an energy harvester is in fact a power supply characterized by an output voltage and an output impedance. So this is a schematic of the energy harvester, and this is in yellow the load. As you know, if you want to maximize the power transfer to the load from the energy harvester, we have to match the impedance of the load and of with the impedance of the power supply. Okay, so by doing that, we obtain the maximum power whose expression is given here. This is really important for the next slides because we want to improve the output power. And the idea is to increase the output voltage and to reduce the output resistance. Okay, just at this point, the efficiency is only 50%. So let's start with the well-known technology called the photovoltaic. The photovoltaic cell consists in a PN junction. Yeah? When a photon, a photon creates an electron hole pair. It's really the principle opposite that is used for the LED lighting. Here you can see a camel. It's in Africa, and it is carrying a solar panel here to power the fridge. Okay, the fridge is used not for beers but for vaccines, in fact. So here it's the best condition. Why? Because it's in outdoor lighting. And it's sunny, so we have, maybe we have up to 1,000 watts. So that's a lot of input power. If it's cloudy, of course, the energy level decreases. And in outdoor lighting, typically the energy level is 3 orders of magnitude lower than outdoors. So in terms of efficiency, so here you can see this curve. This curve represents the widely used technique that consists in multicrystalline cells, with an efficiency around 20%. Here you can see this curve represents monocrystalline cells. They have a higher efficiency, but they are much more expensive. And this is interesting. This is an emerging technology called organic photovoltaic cell, like this one. It is made of polymer. It is flexible. It is light. It can be processed by the wall-to-wall process, that is a low-cost manufacturing process. It can be semi-transparent, but the efficiency is quite low, and it suffers from packaging issues, so that it's mainly dedicated for indoors. Okay. So one cell delivers a voltage ranging from 0.4 up to 0.7 volts. As you can see here, this is the current voltage characteristic of a monocrystalline cell, one single cell. And indeed, the open circuit voltage approaches 0.7 volts. This is in red, the power density. And as you can see, the power density is obtained by the product of the current and the voltage. It reaches a maximum at this point, and this particular point is named the maximum power point. It corresponds to the largest rectangle here. And here, this voltage corresponds to 75% of the open circuit voltage. In power management, a widely used technique is called the maximum power point tracking, so to reach this point. So let's continue with the piezoelectric generator. They use vibration, shocks, etc. Here you have a beam, and a flexible beam, and here you have a mass. The beam is coated with two layers of piezoelectric materials. if you apply a vibration to the frame here, there are some strains in the piezoelectric layers. And the strains involve stresses, and the stresses induce a voltage. Okay? In opposition, the reverse effect is used for MEMS or in MEMS or in for loudspeakers. So how does it work? Here you have a crystal of quartz. It is composed of positive atom in green and in of negative atom here in blue. Without any stress, there is no voltage. But as soon as you apply a load, tension or compression, a voltage appears. Yeah? This is due to the lattice deformation. In practice, there are two ways to extract the induced voltage. Here, either in the same direction as the applied load or in the transverse direction. There are different types of materials. The quartz is a mineral, the PZT is a ceramic, and the PVDF, so I have here a sample. Yeah. So you can see it's flexible, it's a polymer, but the piezoelectric coefficient is quite low compared to ceramics. So this is the setup, and from a mechanical point of view, it can be seen as a mass, a spring, and a damper. As you know, at the resonant frequency, the amplitude is maximum. But if you add a damping, like here, the amplitude decreases. But in the same time, the bandwidth increases. So they deliver a current, but it's an AC current because of the alternated excitation. So we need a rectifier. Hopefully the output voltage is quite high. So let's continue with the electromagnetic generator. Again, they use vibration, shocks, or slow motion. Here, this is a commercial product. This is a batteryless and a wireless push button to switch off or to switch on a light. Here, this is a flashlight. The flashlight is used, uses a coil and a magnet. So, this is an example. We have here a magnet acting as a mass and a spring. If we have some vibration, we have a motion, and this motion will induce a flux variation. So here you have a copper coil, and there is an induced voltage. Okay, this is the induced voltage. And this is Faraday's law. If you want to increase the induced voltage, we have to increase the number of turns. But in the same time, if you increase the number of turns, you also increase the output resistance. Yeah? So the electromagnetic harvesters deliver AC voltage, but the output voltage is quite low, in fact, and it's a problem because we need a rectifier after, because it's an AC voltage. Now let's switch to the thermoelectric generator. Here, they can use the heat flux, or sometimes we use a variable temperature. Let's say outdoors. Okay, the temperature is changing, and we need a thermal battery. What is a thermal battery? It can be simply a huge copper block, so that its temperature is different than the surrounding. So we have a heat flux. Here you can see a batteryless watch, and here it's a batteryless and wireless thermostat. Okay, and the principle. This is an iron bar. If I heat one end and I use a voltmeter, I will observe a voltage. This is due to the Seebeck effect. The voltage increases with the Seebeck coefficient. Now, if I use two metal, like here, so you know this is a thermocouple. Okay, we have a thermoelectric voltage here and another thermoelectric voltage here. But as the Seebeck coefficients are different, there is a resulting voltage here. The thermoelectric generator, in fact, consists in many thermocouples in series to increase, of course, the output voltage. There are two types. We can use a couple of metals, but it's preferable to use a couple of semiconductors for two reasons. The first one is that the Seebeck coefficient is much higher for semiconductors. The second reason is that we can combine negative semiconductor with a positive semiconductor, as shown here. Okay? So that the Seebeck coefficient is positive and negative respectively. So in this loop now, the two voltages are added, so it's better. And again, we can add many thermocouples in series in order to increase the output voltage. Yeah. So here you have a thermoelectric generator with the what is called the hot plate and the cold plate. So, to improve the efficiency of such a device, we have to reduce the thermal conductivity to keep a large temperature difference, while increasing the electrical conductivity to reduce the electrical losses, and of course to increase the Seebeck coefficient. So, in summary, we have to increase the thermoelectric figure of merit ZT given by this expression, where T is in fact the temperature. So they deliver a DC current, but the output voltage is quite low. This is in practice a problem because we need to add a boost converter with a really low startup voltage, and it's a challenge in practice. They have a low efficiency ranging from 5 to 8%, and it is sensitive to the heat flux direction. And don't forget that if you want to increase the input power, sometimes you have to add the heat sink. So it can be bulky in the end. I will say a few words about macroheat engine, which use heat or fluid under pressure. They are based on thermodynamic cycles. The efficiency collapses with the miniaturization because of the relative roughness of the surface, because of scale effects, etc. Also, the overall efficiency is quite low because there are several energy conversions involved. And we have moving parts causing wear, vibration, fatigue, and friction. So the last technique I will describe is the capacitive generator. Again, they use vibration, shocks, slow motion. Okay, so here, let's consider that you have a capacitor, a preliminary charge, and a moving frame. Okay, when the frame moves, the capacitance changes. Okay, so here you have the expression of the capacitance. So you have to pull on the frame let's say while pulling on the frame, you inject power inside the system, and the energy is given by this expression. There are different ways of implementation as shown here. Here, the frame is moving left and right, or up and down, etc. To increase the capacitance, we use interdigital electrodes. They deliver AC currents. Probably the main issue of this technique is that we need a pre-charge, so we need an auxiliary supply. Okay, let's say if we are not far, if we are in indoors, not far from a Wi-Fi hotspot, sometimes we can use radio frequency, simply using an antenna to harvest energy. You know the tribal electricity, okay? So the friction creates charges. There is also the pyroelectric method, etc. If you want to increase the power density, we can mix two principles. For example, here on this figure, you can see piezoelectric beam combined with an electrodynamic device consisting in a magnet and in a coil. Okay, sometimes you can also use a solar cell like this one. Okay, this is a solar cell. But when it's exposed to the sunlight, its temperature rises, sometimes up to 50 or 60 degrees. Okay, the heat will decrease the efficiency some, so it's interesting to cool down the photovoltaic cell. And why not? A good idea is to use, let's say, so you have the solar cell here, you add a thermoelectric generator, and of course, you need to increase the heat flux, you add heat sink. So now I still have three slides about the power management. The first one is dedicated to it is used to describe all the energy conversions. So starting from an input power, let's consider the light. Okay, of course, the input power is different if you consider, when it's sunny or cloudy. The same, the output power of the energy harvester is affected by its efficiency. The output power is higher when it's single crystal, so a monocrystalline solar cell. It's better than if it's an organic photovoltaic cell in terms of efficiency. But as said before, the input power is varying, okay? It's fluctuating day and night, typically. So we have to store the energy. So we can use here a rechargeable battery, but during the charging of the battery, there are some losses. And also during the storage, because the amount of energy decreases due to self-discharge effects. Then we extract the stored energy to feed the device or the IoT device. Sometimes also in some conditions, we can use directly the output power from the energy harvester to the device. This illustration comes from EPIS. EPIS is a Belgian company developing a power management unit. This component is dedicated for solar cells, as you can see, and even for low light conditions, so in indoor conditions. As you can see, it can perform the maximum power point tracking. It can use different kind of storage element, such as a supercapacitor. So here we have a supercapacitor of almost 1 farad, a lithium ion cell. Sometimes we can also use solid state battery like this one, very thin, and other techniques. Here we can add a backup battery. Okay, like this one, it's a coin cell. And it delivers here a high voltage dedicated, let's say, for the communication unit or for some sensors, but also a low voltage. It's to be used by the microcontroller. And there are different types of DC to DC converters. Probably the most simple one is the linear voltage regulator. But in some conditions, the efficiency is quite low. Then there are the step-down or buck converters. Also the step-up or boost converters. And finally, the charge pumps. In terms of requirements, they need to have the lowest startup voltage. As discussed before, in energy harvester, we have no starting energy. So the first IC, so integrated circuit, should start alone. And we need to start it as soon as possible. As described before, a thermoelectric generator provides an output voltage quite low. For example, 0.1 volt, and we have to start up the IC with that voltage. Also, it's an IC, so it has a power consumption because there are some clocks, etc. So this power consumption should be as low as possible to reduce waste of energy. As discussed, for piezoelectric, for electromagnetics, or for capacitive generators, we have an AC voltage. So we need a rectifier. There are different kinds. The most simple one is a diode bridge. Okay, but don't forget that a diode is characterized by a forward voltage drop. So I mean that we have significant losses when the output voltage is low. We can use a MOSFET bridge, or sometimes we can also use active techniques. Okay, if we have IC components, we need power to feed them. But in the end, there are some benefits, and it's interesting to use active rectifying. And last but not least, it's important to transfer the maximum power from the energy harvester to the load. And so the DC to DC converter should be able to perform the impedance matching. Okay, so thank you for your attention. That's all.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so thank you, Philippe, for the very nice presentation. So, is there some question? Corentin, if there's question, I provided in the chat.
Okay. Do I have to quit the presentation or not? Because I cannot see the chat. I have one single screen. So if you have any question, please just ask me. It's easier.
It appears that there is no question in the chat. Yeah.
it was clear.
maybe I can ask one question, Philippe. What is the minimum voltage that or the maximum voltage that we can reach when we use an energy harvester system?
The maximum.
Yeah.
Okay. The maximum of I will say tens of volt, but most of the time, yes, maybe with electrostatic or, then you need buck converters. So it's not really, we try to have such a large output voltage. Let's say the good range is, a few volts. 3 volts, 5 volts is excellent. When it's too low, it's hard. I think that the lowest start of voltage is around 10 to 20 millivolts. It's but most of the time for boost converters, it starts around 0.1 to 0.3 volts. Okay.
So there is now a question in the chat. Sure. So one question is given by Erwan Guy-Louis. I don't know if you can see the question, but I can read it. What is the reliability of these techniques and linked the life expectancy?
Okay, yes, that's an excellent question because, of course, the competitor is... This is the main competitor, so the battery. I will say it depends on the technique. Probably the most a well-established technology, if it's the solar cell, for sure. I think after 20 years, the efficiency is still 80% of the initial efficiency. When you have moving parts, it's for piezoelectric, if you use ceramics, after a large number of cycles, you can have micro cracking, for example, and then the efficiency is reduced. Okay, for the electromagnetic generators, it's quite stable as long as the temperature is low compared to the Curie temperature. Temperature of Curie, of this is related to the magnet properties. Okay, but let's say at a temperature lower than 60 degree, you have just a copper coil that is stable, and a permanent magnet can be a neodymium iron bore. Those are really good magnets. Okay, thermoelectric generators. It's not that easy because there are some thermal interface between, let's say, the heat sink. Okay, so you have here the thermoelectric generator and here the heat sink. Due to CTE mismatch, okay, we can have the heat flux can be reduced over time. Okay, I don't know if there are other questions.
Yes, there is two more questions from Pascal Doré. Where these circuits took their energy?
Which circuit? The
Where these circuits took their energy?
This one? Okay, so I'm not sure to have a proper understanding of the question, but the circuit can be, okay, let's restart with this slide. Okay, this. The electronic circuit, so the PCB hosts the power management, that is typically an IC with passive components, and also the microsystems with IC sensors and the microcontrollers. Okay, this requires energy. Of course, the power management unit should. Okay, this set of components should have an ultra low power power consumption. Okay, it's important. And the energy is comes from the gross energy. It can be light, heat, mechanics, or waves, using the different technique I have just presented. I don't know if the answer is suitable.
I think it's good.
Okay.
What is the lifetime of this battery?
Okay, the lifetime is related to the power consumption of this. It depends again. If you want to monitor the temperature every hour, even with this small battery, we can reach 10 years with this battery. So I think that energy harvesting is really appropriated when the power consumption is low, but not that low. Okay, but also when it's hard it's difficult to replace the battery because it's typically in a remote location. It's far away. For example, for the structure health monitoring, it can be under a bridge. It's not that easy to replace a battery with a screwdriver.
We have a comment. You proposed the hybrid solution. Mm-hmm. Yes, like combining electrodynamic plus piezoelectric to harvest more energy. Mm-hmm. Are there possibilities to combine more than just two ways to harvest energy?
Yes, I think so. Yes, for sure. But really, it depends on the use case, on the cost, on the size you have. You can use. Yes, probably you can use more than two techniques to combine more than two techniques.
Okay, so
yes, maybe yes. Just something interesting here when you have the electrodynamic combined with the piezoelectric principle, it can be interesting because the piezoelectric will deliver a large output power. It can be used, let's say, to start the DC to DC converter, or maybe the active rectifying, used then to transmit a large power using the electrodynamic harvester. So sometimes it can be useful to combine different techniques because, it's a different output voltage. This.
Okay, so there is no more questions. So I think it's time to conclude this presentation. So thank you again, Philippe, for this presentation and for the time that you give to us. Hope to see you next time in Bordeaux yes. For the next edition mm-hmm. of this summer school. And thank you to everyone that are here and connected to follow your presentation. And if there is some additional question, I think that Philippe is aware to answer by email to your questions.
Yes. Okay.
Okay. Thank you and see you. Bye.
Yes, bye. Thank you. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.